need to act. Each year, our world gets warmer, leading to droughts, extreme weather, and environmental inequality. The world is crying out for real change. What can we do? We work smarter. In 2020, Lenovo hit a sustainability milestone of 92% reduced emissions. But our part is not done. We are coming together and enacting science-based targets. What are science-based targets? They are emissions reduction goals based on environmental science. This world is on a path towards a 4 to 6 degrees Celsius increase by 2050. Scientists say, if we can limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, we can significantly limit our damage to the environment. So Lenovo will reduce emissions by 50% by 2030 and emissions intensity by 25%. We are identifying what it will take to be fully carbon balanced by 2050. We are committed to relying on science and action to guide us through this smarter journey to build a better and more sustainable future.
Hello, everyone. I'm Timothy Goh. You're watching The Green Conversation, where we will talk about the role technology plays in environmental conservation and what we can all do to help out. So in this session, we will find out what you and the companies you support are doing that affects the environment. We will learn what companies, big and small, are doing now that helps reduce carbon footprint. Can we put together a 360-degree approach to consolidate efforts by enterprises and consumers? I'm sure we can. And then we will delve into the role that each of us can play to make sure we move towards a sustainable future. Now, before we begin our discussion, let me introduce our panel of experts. In fact, I'll do something different and let them introduce themselves first. Let's start with the gentleman closest to me.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ronnie Lee, General Manager of Lenovo Singapore, and I firmly believe the role of technology that can play in circular economy.
Thanks, Tim. Paul Marriott, I'm the President of SAP Asia Pacific Japan. Great to be here and supporting our sustainable future.
Hi everyone, Megan Z here, Director of Partnerships, Head of Events Engagement at EcoBusiness. Super excited to be here with my esteemed panelists to be talking about today's super important topic.
Hi, I'm Adrian, head of the MD's office at Ricoh Singapore, where CSR is part of the portfolio, and it's a passion of mine. Great to be here.
Thank you very much, everyone. So here's what's going to happen in the next 30 or 40 minutes. We will kick things off with Ronnie Lee giving us an overview of Lenovo's targets and efforts in bringing sustainable technology for all. And then we will have an open discussion with our panel and how they are doing their part and what their companies are doing as well that helps in lowering our carbon footprint. Now, if you are taking part in this one, of course, you stand a chance to win as well some of the prizes we're giving away this afternoon. If you took part in our poll this week, then stay until the end of this session because we will announce the lucky winners of some cool sustainable prizes from Stojo. And several of you will also get a chance to win a $25 gift voucher from Scoop. All you have to do is really leave a question, leave a comment right below, and somebody will get back to you on those answers that you need. Now, before we continue, let's listen to Lenovo's chairman and CEO, Yang Yuanqing, on Lenovo's sustainability journey and goals.
At Lenovo, our mission is to deliver smarter technology for all. With that mission comes an understanding of our responsibility to guarantee a more sustainable future for you and the world we are living in. I'm extremely proud that in 2020, we hit our sustainability milestone goals, but our part in this is not done. That is why today, we are announcing a reset of our objectives so that we can make a larger contribution to limiting climate change. We are going further than ever before, setting ambitious, informed targets for 2030 as a part of the Science-Based Targets Initiative. With the current rate of climate change, world temperatures will rise by 4 to 6 degrees Celsius by 2050, resulting in extreme weather events that threaten the way we live and do business across the globe. So how do we propose to make an impact? Our target will support limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, bringing us closer to net zero greenhouse gas emissions. By 2030, we commit to reduce our operational emissions by 50% and the emission intensity in parts of our value chain by 25%. Beyond this, we are working to size what it would take to be fully carbon balanced by 2050. As we develop transformative technologies to improve our world, we will rely on science and our actions to guide us through this smart journey. We want to build a better and a sustainable future so that the smart technology continues to empower everyone, everywhere.
Let's talk about sustainability plans beyond the numbers. Ronnie Lee, General Manager of Lenovo Singapore, is on the hot seat right now. Ronnie, we just saw the chairman and CEO of Lenovo there, your boss, talking about Lenovo's sustainability journey and plans for the future using science-based targets. So can you tell us more about this journey that Lenovo is taking on?
Thanks, Tim. Now, as one of the world's largest tech companies, and we want to be able to do our part and show solidarity and alignment in the global fight against climate change. All right, and I think the approach we are using is really to make sure that whatever we are doing, we are not doing it alone, and it's actually in unison with what the whole community, the whole world is trying to do. And I think the ultimate objective is really to limit global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial levels. All right, and we have actually set ourselves a target in 2020 to reduce 50% of the greenhouse gas emission by 2030. And the good news is 10 years ago, we started on this journey, and we have already reduced 40%. So you do the math, 40 plus 50, very good. All right, and of course, along that process, in the day-to-day work we have, we are committed to using recycled plastics in the manufacture of our products. And also because this is part of a bigger ecosystem, we want to make sure that suppliers are also working along with us to make sure that our products can be responsibly recycled. And the good news is, this is in line with what the Singapore government is trying to do.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Lenovo is spearheading this, I understand, from a scheme that you're calling the Carbon Offset Service and Asset Recovery Service. Can you tell us more about this?
Right. You see, today, Lenovo like to approach this from a really customer-centric angle. Now, I am an IT provider. I will do my part to make sure that the processes I have, the products I have, are recyclable, mm-hmm. but at the same time, you know, when we are talking to the customers, there are many customers who are telling us that, hey, I want to play a part in what you're doing, all right? And how do you make it easy for me to participate? All right, so here comes CO2 offset service. Now, it's a service whereby the customer can work along with us to identify, you know, the amount of carbon offset they want to achieve. And through that, we are also partnering with a company that's liaising with United Nations, right, investing in projects that helps to reduce carbon footprint. Now, whether is it building windmills, solar cells, biomass, all right, or afforestation, all right, I mean, it kind of gives the customer that driving seat position to say, hey, you can now do something different alongside your IT procurement. All right, and I think the beauty of this is, well, it's a flexible program, all right, you choose what you want, the amount you want to achieve in the period of time that's most suitable for you, and we'll get it done together with you.
All right, of course, it takes an entire community, entire world, not just companies, not just you, but all of us together to do something for the environment. So let's bring in the rest of our panel now and find out what their companies are doing as well in their sustainability push for a better environment in the future. Let's begin with, well, ladies first. How about that? Megan from EcoBusiness, what is EcoBusiness doing?
Thank you, Tim. EcoBusiness is such a great company, I must say. So we were established back in 2009, and I must say we're the leading media and business intelligence company that's really dedicated to ESG performance and sustainable development. So, mm-hmm. I mean, other than, you know, publishing and producing, you know, high quality trusted news on all things sustainability and ESG, you know, on business and policy developments all over the world, we also provide research and consulting for our clients, you know, providing strategic value for, you know, their ESG sustainability strategies going ahead. And also, you know, we own and produce thought leadership platforms as well, you know, informing policy making, improving business practices as well, you know, globally. So I'm very, very proud to be a part of them.
Adrian, what about RICO Singapore? What is it doing to in the sustainability drive?
Well, we all know about the three R's, right? So there's reduce, reuse, and recycle. Now, the recycle bit, I think every company has somewhat in hand. We make sure we give it to the correct waste vendors, get it recycled. When it comes to reuse and circular economy, we take back the machines that still can be functional, and we slap a label on it, call it the green machines. We let customers know that these are pre-loved, like your used cars. But if you don't mind it, why not give it a second chance at life? You know, and it goes out there, of course, at a discounted rate. Everyone's happy. It's a win-win for everyone. Now, the big problem is reduce. Now, what we're trying to do now, and it's not available yet, I must say, is that we're trying to figure out how we can reduce waste in the first place. So think back about how we used to use, I don't know if you remember the Nokia 3310, mm-hmm. where you don't have to change phones every year, like what we do now with iPhones and Androids. You change the cover. Actually, you reduce the waste, right? So we're thinking, okay, can we do it the same way with our machines? And a copier is a copier. The look and function looks the same all the time. So we're saying, okay, people want an upgrade, like a car. You want a faster car. You want a faster copier machine. So what if we change the engine, throw down the firmware upgrades, make it work, but the shell is the same? What does that mean? That means that you don't waste the plastic. What you do, exchange, are made of metal, parts that can be recycled easier. And it's something that we're experimenting on right now. We're not sure if the market will take to it. We think it's a good plan. We're just hoping the timing is right. Everyone, you know, will feel that, yeah, it's something that we want to do. It will not help us if everyone's a fashionista. I want the latest, newest, you know, cleanest. But I guess if there's a cultural shift, paradigm shift to people who are thinkers of what we're buying, it should work. Hmm. So that's something that we're doing.
Paul, what role does SAP play in all this?
Well, first, sign me up for some of the, you know, some of the recycled printers. I'm very in for some of those. So SAP, you know, we've always been a very purpose-driven organization. So mm-hmm. we look to, you know, improve how the world runs, improve people's lives. And in Asia, when I got introduced, I talked about, you know, creating the sustainable future. And we do that through a couple of mechanisms. We have to be an exemplar. It was great to hear, you know, Ronnie and my colleagues talking about what they're doing. We've been doing sustainability for over 10 years. We set targets back, you know, 2009, 2010, and achieved those. We just reset our carbon neutrality target, which was at 2025. We just accelerated that now for 2023. We're really proud that we have sat for the last 4 years as the number one on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index with respect to our industry. And we are a cloud services company, and 100% of our cloud services are delivered through green renewable services. So, you know, we're really committed. I think you have to be committed as a provider. And then what we do is we take the software and services that we have and work with our customers, with the ecosystems, to look at how we make those organizations sustainable. And I think you can't do it on your own. You've absolutely got to do it as a collective and with the audience as well. I think if we all participate in what we can then drive collectively, that's where you get the material impact. So absolutely. Yeah.
Participate, I guess that's the key word, where we can drive this all together. But why is there a push, well, apart from what we're seeing now in regards to climate change, even here in Singapore, why is there a push in recent years, especially by tech companies, to do more for a sustainable future, Adrian?
Well, I can't speak for every tech company out there, but Ricoh being Japanese, there's a strong history as to how we build companies up. If you ask today's children, what is the purpose of a company? They tell you, oh, to make money, to make profits. But to the old-timers who created companies, companies were meant to be to provide to the society stable jobs, you know, give back to society. It wasn't all about the shareholders. It wasn't all about profits. And this has retained in the Ricoh's motto, our lifeblood. We believe in this. We do projects that may not necessarily bring us profit, but we understand that we need to make it sustainable. We need to make sure the trees are still green. We still have to make sure that there's a future for our children. So it's not always about profits. So I understand when people ask me that question, they always ask, what's in it for the company? What's in it for me? What's in it? But it's not always that. It's about giving back. I know it sounds holistic. I know it sounds a bit, but that's true. It's what we are.
Well, what's in it for you? Here's a reminder to send those questions in if you need some answers. And what's in it for all of us, really? We will choose a winner for some of our prizes right here. Oh, they're gone, but they were right here beside me. You get a chance to win some sustainable products from Stojo and a voucher from Scoop as well. Several winners will be chosen this afternoon. Now, getting back to our discussion here, Paul, we know setting sustainability goals, we're all doing it, but trying to achieve these goals, even taking the first step for many of us, is the most challenging part. So how do we overcome this?
Yeah, and maybe building on what Adrian was saying, I think you can't manage what you can't measure. And I think the reason why the tech industry is so motivated is that tech and data, when used together, you know, gives you that transparency. So, you know, what tech companies can do is, you know, for the first step of really solving, say, emission reduction is knowing what you're currently dealing with. So, I mean, I think what's good now is we see, like in Asia, right, it's 17 billion tons a year. It's the biggest polluter on the planet, nothing to be proud of. But we see that at the country levels, we see it at an industry level and at an organization level. Now, you increasingly see, hey, what is my carbon footprint as an organization? But that's sort of still touching the kind of skimming the surface in the sense that I think as consumers, like our kids, right, the consumers, when they buy a product, either now or in the future, are going to demand the sustainable sourcing of that product. And you think about a product and its life cycle, it's very sophisticated. Raw materials, they come from all over the world. Many suppliers participate in the manufacturing. It goes and gets packaged. It then gets transported and distributed, and that's already oversimplifying that process of creating a product or a service. So what's crucial is using technology to create end-to-end transparency. And when you do that, you can look at the footprint of a product or a service, and you look at a footprint not just of your own organization, but the upstream and downstream suppliers that are part of that, right? And that's this scope 2, scope 3. So an organization then has this end-to-end visibility. Once you've got the transparency, you can then increasingly obviously address that in the way you use technology to reduce the footprint, move to, you know, circular processes and zero waste process. So yeah, I think tech plays a massive role. And hence why you've got a very tech-motivated audience here.
That's why we're all here today. Well, did you know that Singapore actually generates 50 million tons of greenhouse gases, which is quite a lot for a small country, Ronnie? What do you think Singapore firms can do, especially in the tech industry, to fight against climate change?
Well, I think as a lot of my fellow speakers have alluded, you know, this is a journey, right? It has to start somewhere. Now, as we all know, first step is always the most difficult.
It's the hardest.
Right? It's the hardest, right? But once you get through the first step, I think what's important is, you know, don't work alone. Work with a bigger group. You know, I'm very sure there are associations out there. There's the authorities out there. Your fellow friendly competitors, people in the industry. I think everyone needs to be able to say, hey, we want to take that one step forward. Of course, the second part of it is really to have yourself have this growth mindset. You know, you're not going to see tremendous result overnight. Yeah, it's something that you have to lay up and you start building. And of course, it helps that authorities are very encouraging these days, even in Singapore itself. All right, and I think as part of the Singapore Green Plan, right, that there has been grant schemes that, you know, if you are interested, you know, you'll be able to kind of get some help. So in a nutshell, well, taking the first step, making sure you have a clear plan, work with your peers, work with people in the industry, associations, and then you'll get there.
So as Ronnie mentioned, it's not an overnight success story. It takes a longer time. And with customers these days into instant gratification, Megan, what part do you think the rest of us can play in this? How do we put these companies accountable, perhaps?
Honestly, I think knowledge, I mean, it's cliche, what's true, knowledge is power. And with everything that, you know, Adrian, Paul, and Ronnie has said, I think it's super important to get the message out there. You know, not only is knowledge important, I think companies should play a really big part as well in educating the public on, you know, creating public awareness campaigns, and that's how you're going to get the knowledge, you know, the information, the data out there to consumers for us to know what actually goes on behind the scenes in terms of your tech production, right? You know, they don't know that what goes on behind the scenes, you know, comes from extraction of metals, you know, like in our everyday products you use, you know, there's like tin, gold, silver, palladium, and all these come from extraction phases, which, you know, harms the environment, you know. And then from there, you have the production phase as well, which then emits so much greenhouse gases. And on top of that, you've got the travel, the global travel of all your electronic products, which emits even more, you know, in greenhouse gases. So all these put together, you know, it's really much, I feel like, a really education public awareness campaign for companies to, you know, shout out into, you know, what exactly is going on and what you're trying to do to make things better, to help consumers make a more informed choice. You know, and buying their everyday technology. And so what, you know, like Adrian said before, we're discussing about, you know, your Nokia 3310s, you know, and how they were so durable last time, and now it's like you drop a phone, it's gone, you know. And I think, you know, we need to think beyond that, you know, we need to think beyond, you know, replacing, buying a new one to replace a spoiled product. You need to think of, you know, how can I repair it? You know, how can I, you know, use what I have until it's super old and broken? I'm going to say, like, I have a Mac Air laptop that's lasted me for about 10 years, and it's still working. So it's like really about how you prolong the life of your products. You know, how do you make sure that, you know, after it's come to the end of the life, you know, that it's properly recycled, that it goes to the correct, you know, disposal bins for companies to do their part, and then, you know, giving back to their environment, you know, in a way. So I always think that knowledge comes first. You know, once you arm yourself with knowledge, you know, that's when you can demand better practices from companies. You know, working from your way up, bottom up. And that's where also then, you know, not only taking those two steps, it's taking the extra step to kind of be more conscious and more considerate and more, you know, just deliberate about making purchasing decisions as well. So it's a little bit like, you know, slow fashion, you know, think about slow tech, right? You know, if you don't need it, you know, don't buy it. If you really buy it, you know, make it last for as long as possible. So yeah, that's really quite simple, I think, from consumer's point of view.
So it's okay.
It's really interesting. Yeah. So I've seen there is, if you look at the fashion industry, there's almost a loyalty, an extra level of loyalty that's emerging, right? So you have fashion companies that manufacture with 100% recycled materials. And then, you know, the consumer, they buy from this brand, and then they pass this back when they don't want to use it anymore. They pass it back, and it becomes part of a constant recycling and loyalty program that builds more and more, you know, focus on sustainability, but actually more customer loyalty in the program. Right. I think that is what will become table stakes for consumers. It's not necessarily pervasive today, but I think 5-10 years, that will be table stakes to participate in the marketplace.
But for tech companies where everything is upgraded and it becomes, well, better, faster products every year now, not during the Nokia years when you know, you can keep a phone for 2-3 years, how do you balance that business interest and the interest of the environment?
Well, personally for me, I mentioned circular economy at the start, right? And I think what works for you now and maybe after a few years, you know, is not good enough for you, we'll still find nice homes in some other you know, function usage. So having a tie back to the whole ecosystem mm-hmm. is very, very important. Mm-hmm. All right. And I think, well, the governments of the world through this pandemic has been encouraging everybody to go digitization. All right. And if we look at even Singapore itself, you know, we are involved in a lot of projects to help out the needy. And sometimes, you know, something that works for them, which may be 3 years, 4 years old, to someone who doesn't have access to that, it becomes very, very right. important. All right. So it's that drive, you know, you get it started and you get things get moving, you know, that motion will run. So maybe to Megan's point, you know, 10-year-old device, somebody can use it for another 5 years and all
that. So something that's not fast enough for my needs anymore will still be good enough for somebody else.
And that will be net positive gain in my opinion. Yeah.
Very interesting. All right. Any final words from any of you? Let's start with you, Adrian.
Well, if I may add to the last point, companies also need to rethink how they report their books, how they report to the shareholders, mm-hmm. because we all want growth. And knowing growth, it means selling more products every year. I think fundamentally we need to shift that to, yes, there still must be growth in profits, but there must be some rethink of how we design our products. Because, like I said, it's easy for Rico to just sell a new copy every year. Another one. But now we're trying to think, let's keep as much as we can and upgrade only the things that need to be upgraded. Because we live in an internet age now. Today, you can stream your Netflix movies. This is the speed we're looking at. Downgrading a firmware is also in the blink of an eye. Right? What may be missing may be that little piece of engine, mm-hmm. and that's what we can change, where everything else remains the same. If it works for my industry, because honestly, nobody gives a copy a second glance. It might not work for phones and everyone else, but it should be something that everyone should be thinking about. Right. So I would encourage, even if you're a small company, rethink your design. You know, work from there. See where we go.
Megan?
Coming from a consumer standpoint, I guess, you know, we use our technology products every day to read, to find out more about what's happening around the world, to connect with people, to communicate, to work. And I think we just need to take a step back sometimes and just realize, you know, what has gone on, what has gone into making that product, you know, and just be, just again, like super mindful and conscious about what, how this product came to be, how it landed in your hands, and how you must really, you know, sort of treasure it, you know, to make sure that it doesn't then go back to mm-hmm. pollute the environment. So I say, you know, always think twice about, you know, your own personal benefit for the detriment of the environment. That's it.
How about you, Paul?
So, well, I think that SAP, we're fortunate that you may or may not know, about 77% of the world's business transactions touch an SAP system. We're a B2B company, so people may not know this. But what that means is that we have an opportunity with software and innovation to accelerate these reductions. And if you look in Asia, the commitment I made between now and 2025 is that if I look at the customers I work with just today, mm-hmm. If we doubled the rate of the Paris Treaty, which I think through technology we can do, we would drop that. We would drop about 1 billion tons of carbon by doubling that rate. And that's where I think we, you know, technology plays a huge role. And certainly with my colleagues, I'd like to work with government, work with everybody in the private and the public sector, you know, to see how we chase for zero emissions and enable that through technology. But it's absolutely a community play, right? We can't do it on our own. We need everybody to be all in, you know, to chase to zero.
Ronnie?
Right. I'll just start off by going back to what I mentioned earlier, right? I mean, getting started. All right. You really need to want to do it for things to happen. All right, you will be really surprised at the amount of work, you know, tech companies, so-called government agencies, associations have been doing. And you know, if you really want to do it and take that first step, I think there are many, many avenues for this journey to go far. And of course, you know, for tech companies like ourselves, who is always on a mission to say, hey, how do I make it simpler, easier for you as well? You know, come on a journey with us, all right? We have web version 1 that you see, CO2 offset. I think there are other versions coming on. And the whole idea is to really get the customer more and more involved in kind of like issues close to our heart, and then really partnering on the journey together. And we'll be surprised that more good things could evolve from there.
Well, as you mentioned, getting started is the hardest part, and having a conversation like what we're having now is a good place to start. And if you have questions, our social media team will try to get the answers from our panel of experts here as well. Very important part of our session this afternoon. If you took part in our poll, stay until the end because we'll be announcing the lucky winners of cool sustainable prices from Stojo, and we have several other lucky winners who will be getting $25 vouchers from Scoop. And of course, we're asking you to do your part, so we are going to bring up the questions that you've been asking. I heard there were a lot of people sending in their questions today. And if your question is chosen, you get a chance to win a Lenovo ANC headset and a Lenovo M10 tablet. We've got two of each to give away, so there will be four questions that we'll be choosing for you. And I think the questions are ready right now, so let's begin. Are you ready, Ronnie?
Yeah, sure. Let's go ahead.
Okay. Now, this question is from Sok Ping Hua. Now, the question is, Ronnie, this is from Sok Ping Hua. I work in an environment where most of my colleagues are elderly, above 60 years old. That's a good thing. We spend a long time to encourage them to accept new technologies and work with technologies. They have accepted and are quite dependent on the technology, but now we love to encourage them to go green and reduce carbon footprint. How can I encourage or educate them about sustainability?
Great question. Great job, Sok Ping, working with your colleagues and really encouraging them to step on the new normal. Now, I think a lot of times it starts with the individual, all right? So today, you know, make it purposeful, taking a really conscious effort to look around yourself and ask yourself, you know, are there so-called recyclable kind of alternatives to the usual things that you are doing, all right? Where, you know, today, like simple exercise, recycling the bottles that you drink from, the Tetra Paks that you use, you know, and you know, today, I guess, in a lot of residential areas, in a lot of today commercial areas, you have recycling bins and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's also going through that journey with your colleagues to let them understand, you know, impacts of global warming. Now we've seen floods, we've seen really disastrous weather lately, even in Singapore itself. And I guess that's also a warning, right, to all of us to say that, hey, it's time to take action. All right, I think nothing serves better than really to have them experience, you know, that little impact that everybody can make that will really make a marked difference in our life.
And I think one of the good things that elderly people are good at doing at home is reusing stuff.
That's right.
So it's something they can also do in the office.
And doing their bit for the circular economy.
Exactly. Yeah. All right, Sok Ping, for that question, you want for yourself the Lenovo M10 tablet. Somebody will get in touch with you about your prize. Now let's move on to the next question. And the next question is from Hang Chung Chun. Hang Chung Chun asks, what is Lenovo's position on environmental management systems like ISO 14001? Are there any targets and goals that Lenovo has set for its environmental performance? Ronnie?
Well, that's really a great question. I think you have seen the earlier videos as well as some sharing we have said, right? I mean, as of 2020, we have actually achieved a milestone and we would like to do more. And what better way to have it coming from the man himself, which is our CEO and Chairman, Mr. Yang. And what we are committing is really to work on industry standards, you know, going back to the science-based targets, right? Doing what is meaningful to really cap temperature increase to 1.5 degrees amidst a backdrop of a 4 to 6 degree increase that is expected. Now, what that means is that there's a lot of work to do, right? And of course, standards like ISO 14001, there are also other international standards that we are also working towards. But the whole idea is we want to commit, you know, from 2020 to 2030, at least 50% of the greenhouse gas emission. And of course, by 2050, we want to be carbon neutral. All right, I think that's really good targets we have. And being the, you know, the entrepreneur in us, we are always setting targets, beating them, and I'm really confident that, you know, we should do it, whether within the time or maybe shorter. Yeah, let's plan for something.
So you have targets, yeah, but you're committed, and that's the most important thing. As you mentioned, there are a lot of things to do. So Hang Chun Chong, you won for yourself another Lenovo M10 tablet for that wonderful question.
Congratulations.
Now let's have a look at the next question, which is coming from, give us a moment here. Here we go. The next question is from Elaine Goh. And Elaine's question is, Ronnie, how Lenovo use technology to reduce carbon footprint? That's a tough question.
Oh, yeah. That's a tough and that's a meaningful question, right? I think there's a lot of things we're doing, you know, again, you know, as the world's largest hardware provider for client products, what we're going to do is to make sure that, you know, within the product itself, you have choices you can make, whether you want to do low voltage processors, you know, that consume lesser energy, you know, energy saving modes that we have incorporated into models that we are selling. Two, also the way we kind of package our final products, as well as, you know, the suppliers we work with, giving them standards that we would like them to adhere to actually help us and help, of course, everyone meet the targets we are setting. Because one thing about what we're doing is we believe, you know, it has to be in unison. It's not about Lenovo or another company or third company, but everybody has to put on that cap and say, hey, I really want to do it, and I want to do it today, not tomorrow, not the day after, because really the world is crying out for our help. And I think for that, alongside with our partner, we are also trying to empower our customers to say, now come work with us. Can we also really set targets with them to help them achieve what they are going through? And I think through a lot of partnerships, through a lot of collaborations, you know, we hope to really expound on the impact we can make, you know, for the whole world.
All right, so not just Lenovo, but your partners and your suppliers.
Absolutely.
And you as well as users of Lenovo.
Yes,
so Elaine, you won for yourself the Lenovo ANC headset for that very tough question. Okay, moving on to our last question for this session, and it comes from Alex Leon. Alex Leon's question is, does Lenovo provide any trade or trade-in program for old laptops to save the environment and reduce carbon footprint through recycling of older laptops?
All right, I think there's two parts to Alex's question. I mean, I'll just answer it by parts.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I think the first part, training programs, yes, you know, we strongly believe in life cycle management of our products. Now, besides trying to make sure that our products are durable, strong, last you for a long time, and again, that's subscribed to that circular economy, right? We always believe that now reusing, recycle is really a good purpose. Now, whether for the components or really working through other users than it needs more, right? And I think during the circuit breaker, it kind of dawned upon us that now around us in Singapore itself, there are also a lot of needy families that need help. And I think through partnerships with a lot of industry players, customers, suppliers alike, I think we are pleased to also share that, you know, we've turned that into really a community service, you know, working with schools, working with really NGOs to make sure that, you know, machines that are pre-loved, all right, they don't just get recycled for money, but at the same time, you know, if they are in good conditions, why not? Mm-hmm. Why not get it working, and then working with NGOs, working with parties that are really familiar with where, you know, the you know, friends of us that actually may need to have a usage of this hardware for the digitization purposes. And I think through that exercise, we really benefited about 300 to 400 families.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just a little bit of refurbishing, maybe not even a factory reset would be good enough, and somebody else can use.
Well, yeah, we have really, really very kind-hearted colleagues of us who spend weekends, you know, trying to touch up the machines, you know, getting it in conditions, you know, that are really, I would say, you know, as good as new, and then getting to the hands of the recipients, and they certainly help to make a lot of difference, you know, especially
during... It takes a community, that's a good effort from your employees volunteering their time cleaning up and refurbishing older laptops. All right, that question from Alex Leon. And Alex, you won for yourself a Lenovo ANC headset. So those are the four main questions that were sent to us with the prize winning questions, I should say. Now, let's have a look at the people, the lucky winners who won for themselves Stojo containers. We are giving away Stojo cups and Stojo containers for those who participated in our LinkedIn poll. And let's have a look at the winners now. For the Stojo Cups, five winners: Tammy Teo, Ashvin Amudan, Pei Yong Xia, Rachel Low, Davison Vira Swami. That's for the five Stojo Cups. Now, for the five Stojo containers, the winners are Lim Kian Peng, Brenda Lim, Merrick Yap, Raman Iyengar, Dave Hong Sang Yun. You want for yourself five Stojo containers. And now we are also giving away Scoop vouchers, $25 worth of Scoop vouchers. Five lucky winners here: Kavita Ravichandran, Ideal Sharil, Darren Yi, Sherilyn Yeo, and Belinda Lim. All right, well, it's time for me to wrap this up and thank our panel of experts for joining us in this discussion today. Remember, the first step, talking about it. Adrian Lim is the head of Managing Director's Office at RICO Singapore. Megan C is Director of Partnership and Head of Events and Engagement at Eco Business. We have Paul Marriott joining us as well. He is the President of SAP Asia Pacific and Japan. And of course, Ronnie Lee, General Manager of Lenovo Singapore. Thank you very much for a very informative discussion, very insightful indeed. Well, that's it on this edition of The Green Conversation. You can find out more about what we're talking about here and Lenovo's sustainability campaign as well. You can check it out at lenovo.com.sg. Thanks for joining us.
It's a new day. And for an IT professional like you, that means new business challenges that require new thinking to solve new problems with new technology. At Lenovo, we've made it our mission to power yours, continuously in pursuit of what's new, so that we can deliver bigger, better, and smarter solutions to help your business thrive. Like helping your team succeed anywhere with Windows 10 Pro, no matter where they choose to work. Modernizing everything from how you buy technology to how it reaches users. And keeping everyone safe with powerful built-in security, courtesy of Windows 10 Pro. Because when it comes to looking forward, it helps to have a partner who backs you all the way. Ready to pursue the new? Lenovo, smarter technology for all.